we are so lucky to have Dr. Riyadh Lafta here with us to share his research. And I'll tell you a little bit about his bio, but then I want to tell you a little bit about what I picked up in the few minutes that we had just before this. He is a professor of medicine at Mustansiriya, did I say it right? Mustansiriya University in Baghdad, and also an affiliate professor at the University of Washington's Department of Global Health. He has been collaborating with researchers at UW, Johns Hopkins University, and Simon Fraser University in British Columbia on a number of studies involving the effects of war on public health, and first started working with the UW faculty in 2005 when they reported the almost tripling of childhood leukemia rates in Basra between 1993 and 2007. And then they conducted a study of 2,000 households in Iraq to report the mortality associated with the U.S. invasion in 2003. Dr. Lafta received his medical degree from the College of Medicine at Baghdad University in 1984 and completed his PhD from the Iraqi Committee for Medical Specialization. He worked in Iraq hospitals between 1984 and 1997, with the Iraq Ministry of Health between 1995 and 97, and as a supervisor for the national immunization campaigns in rural areas for UNICEF for a year after that. He has completed several projects with the World Health Organization, and his research is focused on a range of population health issues, including conflict epidemiology, malaria screening, pregnancy outcomes, vaccines, diabetes, obesity, and injury. That's his bio on paper, and it's incredibly impressive. But what I have really appreciated just in our short conversation is that this work is incredibly dangerous. I know that every day you take risks with your life. And we were talking about the idea that when you speak out against what the government is doing, there is opposition. And you never know where that opposition is going to come from. I have a little bit of that experience myself. And I think that it is incredibly important for us all to understand how much we have to do here to make sure that Dr. Lafta can do his work in Iraq, and that we are deeply connected through these bonds of humanity. And when we release weapons, and when we have, when we invest in nuclear weapons, when we agree to move certain budget provisions forward in the United States, it is a direct consequence that has these effects 13 years later, 5 years later, 50 years later. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Riyadh Lafta.
Thank you very much, all of you, for your welcoming and for your attendance here. Life in Baghdad today, 13 years after the U.S. invasion, well, some like to call it liberty after liberty. I used to call it invasion always, and we'll keep on that. What is the state of public health? This is a revision of what is the condition and the status of the community and the health system in respect with public health, presented by numbers from Ministry of Health, from organizations, and from our work by house to house. Okay. During the 70s and 80s, Iraqi healthcare and medical education were said to be the best in the region. The country boosted free health care in 172 hospitals and 1,200 primary health care clinics. Iraqi medical graduates would often receive specialty training and certifications in the UK. The destruction and looting of health facilities that followed the 2003 invasion resulted in heavy loss of equipment and pharmaceutical stocks. Quality of care continued to deteriorate and shortages were widespread. Major loss of health staff from tertiary hospitals had an effect on teaching, training, and care of patients. About 22.9 to 29.7% of Iraqis live in poverty, and these numbers are from the Ministry of Planning in Iraq and from the different NGOs, and this can be underestimated, but not overestimated. And I'm sure all of you know what does it mean to be below the line of poverty. Access, especially in a country like Iraq with this large quantity of oil underneath. Access to safe water and sanitation is low. The 2013 Human Development Index for Iraq is 0.573, below the average for Arab states and other middle-income countries. Pre-invasion mortality rate, means prior to 2003, was 5.5 per thousand per year, compared to 13.3 in the 40 months post-invasion. That means more than 2.5-fold. And this resulted, of course, from the direct effect of war, that's violence, and the indirect effect on the health system, on the sewage system, on infrastructure, water supply, electricity, transportation, and all these issues that are the basis of public health and can relate to health. According to the most recent UN reports, 5 million Iraqis are externally displaced, and 4 million are internally displaced. Unemployment is a major problem, especially young adults. Literacy declined. School enrollment dropped from 99% in the late 80s and early 90s to 70% or even lower than that. And the illiteracy among women now is 30 to 35%, while in the late 80s, as I remember, it was almost zero for men and women. Now it is among men 25 to 30, and among women 30 to 35%, means more than third the women community in Iraq are now illiterate. Communicable diseases outbreaks continue, particularly outbreaks of cholera and dysentery, related to the severe environmental and infrastructure damage during the first Gulf War, with additional damage after the 2003 invasion. An outbreak of hepatitis E was reported in Baghdad in 2011. During 2012, northern Iraq had a major cholera outbreak, followed a previous outbreak that affected many areas, including Baghdad. Measles epidemic in 2014 and mumps epidemic in 2015. These things were forgotten in the previous years. Tuberculosis, pulmonary tuberculosis, continues to be a problem with a prevalence of 70 to 80 per 100,000. 203 multi-drug resistant cases were detected in 2011, up from 115 in 2009. Leishmaniasis continues to be a problem in some areas. Scabies is widespread in epidemics, especially among ITBs and prisoners. Schistosomiasis and varicella are also common. HIV is not a major problem, or maybe you don't have enough reports for that. In 2011, only 615 cases were reported. New cases might increase now that movement across Iraq's border is increasing with no strict control measures. Non-communicable diseases pose the largest disease threat to Iraq's population. These are also forgotten diseases because people take it as a non-urgent, non-emergency disease, while they are considered in the whole world as silent killers. Results of 2006 WHO survey of 4,800 households showed that 42% of men smoke, 67% of adults have a body mass index greater than 25, more than 40% had both systolic and diastolic hypertension, more than 10% had hyperglycemia, although only 6.5% said that they had been diagnosed with diabetes. 50% reported a low level of regular physical activity. Increasing the case fatality rate for myocardial infarctions attributed to the deteriorated capacities of intensive care units. Cancers are an emerging concern, with rates of childhood cancers higher than those in high-income countries. A doubling of childhood leukemia has been reported from Basra over a 15-year period. And as you know, we are now going in what we call epidemiological transition phase. That is, we're still having the diseases of poor sanitation and hygiene and poor nutrition, like infectious diseases. At the same time, we are catching the disease of the developed countries, like ischemic heart disease and coronary heart disease, chronic non-communicable heart disease, cancers, without being a developed country. Violence is increasing in a sustainable, accelerated pattern. 150,000 people are physically disabled by landmines, conflict, and other remnants of decades of war. Psychological trauma is one of the most major but neglected health problems. 15% of newborn babies are estimated to have low birth weight, and neonatal deaths account for more than half the deaths of children younger than 5. 6% of children younger than 5 years are mildly or moderately underweight, and 26% are stunted. Exclusive breastfeeding among children younger than 6 months of age is only 31%. Many birth defects have been noticed from hospitals, especially in Fallujah. 30 to 40% of births are reported by Iraqi MOH to be cesarean sections. Iraq has 222 hospitals, including 61 teaching hospitals and 92 private hospitals. Primary health care is provided by 2,500 primary health care centers distributed all over Iraq, but half of them, unfortunately, with no medical doctor. Much of the population receives health care through an estimated 10,000 to 12,000 private clinics staffed by off-duty doctors from the public sector. When we say private, people pay for that. Richer households are more likely to use private clinics than the public sector PHCs that are preferred by poorer households and usually suboptimum. Before the 2003 invasion, Iraq had an estimated 34,000 medical doctors, many of whom were teaching faculty. Many doctors left Iraq during the height of the conflict or were killed. This outflow has now lessened, although of the 2,000 to 2,200 new medical graduates each year, about a quarter leaves. Efforts to encourage migrant Iraqi doctors to return have been largely unsuccessful because the reasons for their migration are still there. So how can they go back? Iraq has 13 hospital beds per 1,000 population, compared with, for example, in Egypt, 17.3. More than half of hospitals were constructed in the 1970s to 80s. The last general governmental hospital in Iraq was built at 1986, and no hospital was built since then. Knowing that the population has been more than doubled since 1986. Putting hospitals in the right place and managing them remains an unrealized goal. Only about 40% of Iraq's population has access to referral service in hospitals from PHCs. And I think it's important to mention here that during the 80s, for example, when I was medical student and medical graduate, I was training in what we call Medical City in Baghdad. At that time, Iraq was the largest and most important medical center in the Middle East. And we used to see patients from different countries, not only the Arab countries, for two reasons. One, the specialist there was very efficient and international figures. Second, the health services, medical services were all for free. And for example, a patient may be admitted to the hospital with a problem in the heart and open heart surgery done to him with, for example, valvular replacement or pacemaker and all these services for a month or more with all the care in the hospital. And all these for how much do you think? Like in USA. It's less than $1. The whole bill. Only he or she needs to get a ticket of admission, which is like $0.7 or $0.8. Now, most of the Iraqis are seeking medical care outside, and most of them cannot afford for that. Private hospitals tend to be small, with an average of only 25 beds. Most admissions to these hospitals are for surgery and deliveries, and few provide general hospital care. A private hospital delivery could cost $500, and a cesarean section, $1,000, well beyond the reach of many Iraqis. Iraq has no health insurance programs, which means all private health care is met out of pocket. No ministry guidelines or regulations exist for private hospitals. Currently, both private hospitals and the clinics are largely outside the national health information and supervision system. 6 weeks ago, three major and teaching hospitals in Baghdad issued documents and distributed to other hospitals about stopping all the surgical elective operations, we call it cold cases, elective operations because of the severe shortage or absence of the essential drugs for anesthesia, like atropine and other drugs. So the patient either waits for a long time, like 5 or 6 months, or if he's rich enough, go and seek this care outside, or accept the current situation, it's called status quo, and wait for his death or complication. Key messages. Iraq's health system is still struggling to recover from years of war, sanctions, loss of health workers, looting, and political interference. Health facilities and health workforce are inequitably distributed to meet the country's health needs. Ostensibly, the family health care approach forms the basis of Iraq's health system, yet the major investments continue to flow into secondary and tertiary health facilities. Health strategy remains weak and uncoordinated, still heavily focused on clinical services, while major public health problems such as smoking, obesity, and non-communicable diseases are not being fully addressed. Healthcare financing and the role of private healthcare are looming issues for the health sector, which are now only tentatively being addressed. The revival plan of the Iraqi healthcare system seems to be very limp so far. Lack of security, bad management, politicization of MOH, corruption, and poor training are all problems that successive decision makers have failed to solve since 2003. The case of sanctions and war have seriously compromised a once proud and functional health system. It now struggles to rebuild itself, having adequate financial resources, but with a shortage of skill and strategies. Although the fragmented health policy seems to emphasize further development of a health system based on the family healthcare model, resources are heavily directed toward expansion of secondary and tertiary healthcare facilities. Human resource development fails to link needs, strategic plans, and training programs together. As the public sector loses its monopoly on the employment of doctors, major changes loom in the health system for which there are as yet no policies. The continuing sectarian insecurity in Iraq makes even the best plans difficult to implement. Future directions. Governance remains heavily centralized and is not transparent. Because of that, hospitals do not have the flexibility to manage their services effectively. Many of the health issues that face Iraq are public health concerns and will not be solved by increasing the sophistication of clinical services. Building of public awareness and momentum for behavior change in areas such as smoking, exercise, and diet must be national priorities. Few data are available to support evidence-based decision-making. Moving from the socialist era of centralized management to a decentralized participatory health system requires skills and capacities that Iraq does not yet have. Creation of a private sector role in healthcare must be done with care and deliberation, with adequate regulation and oversight to deliver value for money to Iraq. Thank you for listening to the presentation and numbers, but I have something else to show you just for 5 minutes without my comment. I think it doesn't need any comment. Just a revision of what the USA have thankfully done in Iraq. I'm sorry if it is annoying to some of you. Thank you very much.
Now, if you have any question or discussion? Yes.
Instructions from the Ministry of Health to report any case of acute plasma paralysis because new cases of poliomyelitis have emerged after 2003. We know this disease was terminated in Iraq and most of the world, but after the war, many cases started to appear. So do you have any numbers, actual rates about poliomyelitis in Iraq now?
Okay. First of all, you know, the program of poliomyelitis is an eradication program. And it has been eradicated in the America and in Europe. But there are still some countries in the Middle East which are still, you know, something more detailed here because acute flaccid paralysis surveillance system. Every case with acute flaccid paralysis should be taken and should be thoroughly investigated just to make sure that it is not polio. Iraq was not eradicated from poliomyelitis, but for the last about 17 or 18 years, no case at all appeared in Iraq. Okay? But we were, according to this surveillance program of AFP, we failed all those years in being free or clean of poliomyelitis because we need 3 years, successive years, to achieve and fill all the requirements for this program. Even without any case, we should achieve other requirements. Deep medical, I don't want to take a long time in that. We couldn't do that for some difficulties. The problem is that about a year ago or more, and because of the problem of displacement and the horrible conditions that displaced people live, we think that we imported a case of poliomyelitis from the refugees from Syria. And the people in Iraq, in certain area, which is near to Baghdad, but it is deep in the rural area, something like hard-to-reach area. They were in contact and got infected. And this will add more time and delay to announce Iraq as polio-free. So this will take time. But generally, the disease now is not a problem. Okay, but still, we cannot say that it is eradicated in Iraq because of that. Thank you. Yes, please.
Sometimes it's difficult to talk about rudiments of casings. Perhaps you could enlighten me on the size of Iraq's oil reserves.
I don't know that.
You don't know. I asked you for a very special
reason. Yeah. But I know that it was, before 2003, number one in the world, the first, the largest in the world. But now it is different.
Okay, well, let me just do a little data with you.
Okay.
The International Energy Associates defines now a mega field in oil as 500 million barrels of oil in one field. 30 years ago, it was a billion barrels, so it's declining. Iraq has 1,000 megafields of oil. Did you hear what I said?
Yeah.
1,000 megafields of oil. That means that when that oil is reorganized, the entire Mediterranean Sea will be reorganized around Iraq.
Exactly.
I'll say one thing. The U.S. will never allow it.
Thank you. I think this probably could be one of the main reasons for the 2003 war, as we think in Iraq.
It is, because why? Russia's long-range missiles from the Caucasus, and of course from the Crimean Peninsula, and now in Syria, completely swamps the southern flank of NATO, which is in Greece.
Thank you. Yes. Actually, I don't have numbers, accurate numbers about before the war Caesarian, but we were following the range that is settled by the WHO and other organizations, which is 5 to 15%. Should better not less than 5 and not more than 15%, which means that there is this range is indicated for the end of pregnancy rather than normal vaginal delivery in from previous surveillance and history. But the problem is that this is increasing in the last years, and it exceeded 40% according to documents from the Ministry of Health. Well, I don't find any reasonable explanation for that, but maybe the change in the trend of the people towards having no pain. At the same time, there is an element of, greed among doctors, unfortunately. I'm sorry to say that, but the gynecologists are doing that because they will make money from these operations. At the same time, they can convince the female, the woman, the pregnant, who is going to deliver, that this is better and will end with few minutes and with no pain, you will just, a few minutes and then you will have your child in your arms and so on. So it's something related to the change in pattern of the concept of people at the same time of the ethical aspects and behavior of doctors with no control and no supervision from the Ministry of Health, especially in the private sector.
I noticed one of the pictures you have that it said it was from the link funnybites.com, and the image is actually very troubling. So it seems the American media isn't really giving us the full picture of what's happening. So we can't really speak out against it or have any kind of social impact to collectively speak out. And it seems like our media just sensationalizes. And speaking of psychological health, this seems very psychologically unhealthy on our parts as America to allow this to happen. It seems like a mental disease to allow these children to be like a form of child abuse, except, it's not our media isn't allowing it. It seems the people that want the oil are also in charge of the media.
Yes, thank you. This is a very important point. And, I think that the media usually tells what they want to tell, or what maybe sometimes what politicians want to tell. Unfortunately, they don't tell the truth from my experience, because I've been contacted with many people here in USA in the past years, and most of them thought that everything is fine in Iraq and we are good and no problems. Well, the second part of your comment about mental health problems. Yes, we started to discover an increasing prevalence of mental health problems. The problem with this issue is that in Iraq, this is like a social stigma. So no one goes to seek medical care or to take a member of his family for that. And they will keep on that until something happens, something bad happens, until complications or until more progression, bad progression in the case happens. So this is the problem. No social, no psychological care or assistance is done in this aspect. No mental health programs are active. So the situation is that we started to register increasing rates of anxiety, depression, behavioral changes, and suicide. Suicide is something which we were not familiar to in Iraq. Now we are registering cases, and we have many cases in the last year in the IDPs camps, adolescents, boys and girls, committed suicide just to get rid of this stress and feeling of humiliation in their camps. And I, even as I told yesterday, there was a case of a mother who killed herself with her three children by throwing them in the river, and they died drowning. Just maybe we couldn't ask her, but we are sure that because she couldn't stand the stress or thinking about the gloomy future that is waiting for them.
Thank you for your presentation. You described a terrifying picture. One of the things that impressed me was the scope and the quality of the health system prior to the war, which was, as you said, the public system and public finance. And then you described the private, the increasing privatization of the healthcare system. I'm curious as to how that process happened. Was this a kind of natural process of privatization because of the breakdown of the government from the war? Was this imposed? Was it intentional to privatize? I'm just curious about that.
Yes, yes. The private sector was there before the 2003. It was present before the 2003, but it was, you know, sort of limited, not like now. Now, because of the deterioration in health services and the long list of waiting in the hospitals and the poor services in hospitals, this private sector is becoming larger and more dominant. So this is the change, but it was present before. It's not part of the general privatization in the whole country. It is growing more rapidly than expected, than meant, and than other sectors. Yes, please.
Thank you very much, doctor, for coming here. I noticed that there was like worsening in the scenario that is going on right now in Iraq in the health sector. Is there any practical steps being taken by professionals? I'm talking about professional, medical professional, because what I hear lately, like the Iraqi officials, they announce there is no fundamentals of government going on right now in Iraq. It's being run by militia. So is there any like group of people did practical step to change that worsening scale to go to change it in somehow practically on the ground? And what was the outcome of that, if there was any?
Like whom? Group of people, for example, because you answered in advance that you say the country is run by militias.
Professionals, because I was working there at RN in Hobi, and I really liked the question about the cesarean sections going on. They were encouraging the women that it was faster, and, which is not in the ethic of the medical profession, and it was by the Hobis, and I really thank you for you're being very honest to talk about them, how greedy they are. But is there like a group working there, volunteers, like doing something to change that worsening system?
Well, yes, there are always good people, sincere people, and want to do something for others. But these people are, you know, their hands are tied, and they can do very little in this aspect. And sometimes when, you know, the policymakers or the people that have the power feel or discover someone who has the not only the intention, but also the potential or the ability to do, to make a change, to make a difference, then this will be not good for him. Okay? If he has any power or position, he will be immediately thrown out, or maybe more than that. And you know what does it mean more than that? That's why most, as I don't know if I mentioned that 20,000 professional doctors left Iraq since 2003. They left Iraq mostly not for seeking better life standards or luxury, although some of them did that, and this, they're right. But most of the people, and we did a survey in that in 2007, most of them left Iraq because they were scared. They wanted to find a safer place for their families. And this is, again, a human right. So deficiency, shortage of these professionals, will make the situation more difficult, because who will lead the change? That's what's happening.
Yes. I just wanted to follow up a little bit on Steve's question. I wanted to follow up on Steve's question about the financing for the health system, and that, you know, the original invasion was a war crime, but your presentation suggests that the crimes are continuing. And one of those crimes might be, you know, the degradation of the health system for the people. And I'm wondering what our government's role is in either not supporting the rebuilding of that system, in promoting privatization. Is there, what has been the role of the United States, USA and other organizations and entities that are working with the Iraqi government to strengthen healthcare in any way? And I guess as an addendum to that, what would you suggest, given that we as Americans are responsible for what's happened, what can we do now? Are there anything that you feel comfortable telling us that we can do? Should we write to our new congresswoman for and ask her to go back for things that might build a better health system? So just
thank you very much. Well, you know, the war usually has immediate consequences and remote consequences. The immediate is the whole devastation and destruction of infrastructure and all the institutions and education and health. The remote consequences is the destruction of the souls of people. And also the infrastructure will stay like that. The system will be disturbed. That cannot be repaired for long time. For a long time, or maybe I don't know. But at least it is not now. There's no evidence that this is easy to repair, okay? And, you know, the assistance, for example, from some people was very, very good and very supportive. Like, for example, I worked with the University of Washington, and during conducting our surveys, they were very helpful regarding the scientific consultation, the logistics, even the funds. But this is very limited. I mean, this cannot solve a problem, a huge problem like what we are living and practicing now. And the last comment for you, if you want to know what do we want you to do as USA, I'm not sure that you want to hear my answer. I'm not going to say it, but because it is just leave us alone. But I'm not going to see. I'm not going to say it. Yes, please.
I think that we're short-sighted in how much the United States is responsible for, because it isn't just the 2003 invasion and war. It's the previous time.
Exactly.
And then so many years of sanctions, which degraded the Iraqi health system and made it very, very difficult. So I don't even have the capacity to ask you an adequate question, but I apologize to you for us.
Thank you very much.
You said three things that Iraqis can do. What would that those top three things to help fix that Iraqis can do?
Yes. I know. But the problem is that when you build a defective system and then expect from the people who are not powerful in that, who have no power to do the change, expect them to do this change, it's difficult for them. We need first to fix the system, the whole system. I'm not going in this deep because I'm not a politician. I don't like talking in that. But I am here, telling you that the system, the whole system is corrupted. And it's not easy. It's not a one gap to fill it. It is all over gaps and defects. So it is hard work, really hard work. Is it possible? Yes, but this needs some miracles, if there are miracles. Need a long time of efforts, of sincere efforts, and good people who want really to build the country, not to destroy it.
Yes. Thank you. I wonder, you've done some really remarkable research in Iraq over the last few years related to the health of the people. I wonder if you could just talk a little bit about what it's like to try to do a survey in Iraq right now, and just a few of the findings that you have, that have been perhaps surprising, and then also maybe your future.
Thank you. It's difficult, of course, now to conduct a survey in Iraq for many reasons. First, the risk is still there. You cannot go everywhere and, for example, ask people or collect information because there is a risk. And you cannot always risk the lives of your team, of your, scientists. This is one. Second, the numbers. If we decided not to go to the field and take numbers, ready-made numbers from, like, Ministry of Health, these numbers are, questionable because usually they are manipulated. And it's not only in Iraq. All the countries who live a state of uncertainty and who are securely unstable. The third thing is the funds. Sometimes you need great funds to go here and there and transportation and wages to the interviewers and other. And this is also, again, not available. And for that, for the last 2 or 3 years, we have conducted many surveys in Iraq, but almost all of them were without funds. We did it by our own or by simple help from our friends, but this is very limited. We cannot do it nationwide because this needs money. Yes.
Were you able to find a connection with uranium 238 with the child malformations? And was your child good leukemia, that sort of thing? Or was it a more vague association with war and with battles that had lots of pollution associated with it? Were you able to identify uranium?
Yes. Unfortunately, we couldn't study these cases of malformations. They were specifically in Fallujah, and there were so many. But nobody dares to help. This one. Maybe the only research that I couldn't do because nobody could go to Fallujah and do that because of the security situation. Well, although we cannot swear that the cause of these malformations was the weapons like depleted uranium or other weapons, chemical or I don't know what, we cannot swear on that. In epidemiology, but we are confident that this is the most probable reason for that, because what else can suddenly change the picture from very expected known number of malformations for so many years and abrupt increase in this number. We think that this is the most probable explanation for that. Yes, another question? Yes, please.
The question was just recently asked about your data collection methods, which are incredible, by the way, and take a lot of bravery. I was curious, do you have a sense, given the limited nature of your ability to give surveys out to the population, do you have a sense of the accuracy of those? How the degree, if they are underestimating these values, do you have a sense of it worse, how much worse?
Yeah, well, usually most of the surveys we have done and we are doing are field surveys, house to house. I would not say we don't trust the official numbers, but usually in many countries with situation of security problems or instability, there is a sort of political influence in the numbers to increase or to decrease or to, not to give any number. So we usually go to the field, to the houses, to the people, and ask them. Of course, this is based on solid methodology and with evidence, documentary evidence, whether for mortality or morbidity or other things. So the numbers can be, I'm confident that they are very accurate. But sometimes we need some numbers that could not be collected from the community. We need it, and we go to Ministry of Health or Ministry of Planning or other sources of, like, NGOs, and we get many numbers. And then we validate the numbers to see if they are very approximate. Then we can decide if they are okay to be, reliable or maybe false. Yes.
For those of us in more privileged situations here, is there a way we can support your work and what you're doing there right now, coming from Seattle, University of Washington?
Well, the door is open always for anyone who wants to help and to do something and to learn, because we are learning, we are all learning. Every survey, we learn more and more. And anyone and any time want to do something, to participate, I think you can arrange with my boss, Amy Hagopian.
Are you experiencing any censorship?
Yeah?
Any censorship in reporting your results, or as a result of reporting any as you publish your results, do you experience any consequences in attempts to censor?
Yeah. Yeah. Of course.
So let me ask you a very direct question. Suppose you were able to find evidence. This is in support of his question.
Yeah.
If you were to be able to find evidence of uranium-238 in the malformations of Fallujah, would you be afraid to publish it?
Me? No. But many people will be. Yeah. Me? No. I'm not afraid. And.
But he's crazy.
Because I am crazy. I will not get it.
I like that craziness. I want to hear it.
Yeah. I'm sorry, but yes, there is danger, always danger, from many people. People who don't like to hear you saying something not true about them, like the politicians say that they are wrong. They never been wrong, the politicians, okay? So when say you committed fatal mistakes, this is not good. They may hate you, and they may express, they say it by different means. Most of them are not good, as you know. Yeah. Yes, please.
What is the general status of medical education now for doctors and nurses across Iraq?
Well, I think they are struggling now. It's not that good, but it is relatively good, I can say, because Because I'm talking about medical education, of course. Medical education has something good in it, which is first is by English, okay? So all those people can learn from the journals, the textbooks, and now the internet and the CDs and other things. So it is relatively good so far. As a teacher, as a professor in medical college, I can say that there is, of course, a problem in a sort of deterioration in the education, but it is not that much. And I'm sure that the doctors that are graduated from Baghdad medical schools, I don't know much about the governors, but they are good enough, not like before, but they are good enough. Yes.
Doctor, you mentioned that there is suicidality rate increased now in Iraq.
Yeah.
Do you have data that shows which areas specifically increased and who are those people? Are they the people who were in the war zone? Or, like, do you have data about that? This is one of the questions. Second, if here there is agency wants to treat, I'm sure that they cannot treat all the numbers that are existing, but they might be able to supervise clinicians working locally. Is there like program like that is possible to do, and who we can go to in that case?
Well, we have numbers about suicide, but these are not very reliable. Why? Because they are not nationwide, not general, for specific groups of people, mostly vulnerable group, like we measure this in women, in IDPs, women, okay? And we measured it in a sample of people that have adverse childhood experiences and its effect on their future behavior and personality. But I can say that these are highly reliable because the population is not representative for the whole population. On the other hand, it's difficult to go there to the field and ask people in Iraq, according to the culture and norms, you cannot go and ask about suicide because this is, again, a stigma. We got our, limited numbers by sending female doctors who are expert in that and interviewing the women in a private place. And we are confident that the numbers are underestimated. So it's difficult to do that. I think, in addition, the small number, the number is not that high. We believe that it is still small, but it is increasing. And I think this is the best point to attack for a public health physician or even any general physician to help in the primary prevention or the early secondary prevention and not wait until the problem, increase and we will start tertiary prevention, which is rehabilitation, which is of limited value in mental health. Yes. Any other question? Any other point?
Right here.
Yes, please.
You mentioned the problem of insufficient pharmaceuticals, that is, medicines, and could you comment on the range of problems that are impacting that issue?
Well, we have deficiency. This is mostly local. Like you can say, there are money, there are funds for pharmaceutical aspect and drugs. And people, most of the times, can get even their cytotoxic drugs, which are very expensive, for free or with very limited price in some centers. But this is not always the case, because this is because of corruption. We have people put in certain positions in Ministry of Health, not on basis of efficiency or experience or other things, mostly on political basis. So those people don't know what to do on one hand, and if they make any mistake or corruption, no one can stop them because they are supported by certain groups, by their groups, their people. And I'm not making this up. The Prime Minister himself said that many times, and he was working for the last 7 or 8 months about this issue to change this pattern of, distributing the positions and chairs according to the political issue. But so far he failed and he could not do anything. We hope that he will be able to do that in the future. Yes?
Just a quick question. What's the current immunization coverage situation in Iraqi primary and secondary healthcare facilities?
Immunization?
Immunization coverage, in particular as far as
yes.
Vaccines availability is concerned?
Yes. Immunization is good. I think from my experience, from my knowledge, and from my relations with the Ministry of Health, I think it's good. The coverage is relatively good, taking the current situation of the main problems that we say, but it's still good enough because maybe vaccines are not difficult to afford, not very expensive, and they are essential for the population. So, thanks God, it's still good. Well, we hope it keeps on that or improved. Yes, please.
Do you have any data regarding malnutrition? You mentioned, or you had shown a picture and image of the marketplace. So, do you have any data regarding?
No. Unfortunately, I don't. But there is data about that. I could not include it here because I couldn't find it in the suitable time. But there are, yeah. Marwa.
Yeah, you mentioned that the mental health problem has increased. Do you have numbers on that?
Of course.
And also, are we seeing more providers in that field, like counselors, psychiatrists, or adults?
Well, first, we have, of course, statistics about that also. Through our survey, house-to-house survey, community public health surveys. And we concluded that about 40% of the population have anxiety and have depression, symptoms of depression, and more than 50% have symptoms of anxiety, okay? And less than, of course, less than 1%, like 0.3 to 4%, has suicidal thoughts or attempts. Okay, we even did that on a group of doctors, junior doctors, and we found the same rate of more than 40 depression and more than 50 anxiety. And we are still working on that, hoping to get more numbers through larger sample. But about the intervention, I think it is subjected to the same difficulties that we are mentioned in the whole health system and in the whole country. We have program, we have mental health program, but it is not well activated. And I think it's time to work on that by, the people in the Ministry of Health, the policy makers and decision makers of MOH.
It's difficult to collaborate thousands of miles away, but there are some military healthcare professionals in Iraq with the U.S. military. What has your relationship been? Have you gotten assistance from them? Have you been part of the conversation when they have reached out or the Iraqi government has reached out?
No.
So you're not aware of any of that?
No, I'm not, because I don't know them, but they can possibly reach me and coordinate with me. And if I feel that they are really doing something of benefit to the population, I won't hesitate. Okay? Yes, doctor.
This reflects my ignorance and my naivete. Why is not everybody fabulously rich in Iraq? Is the oil not being pumped out, or is it being pumped out and all the money is going back to the corporations and the United States reparations or whatever?
A small distribution. Small distribution of the fortunes. Very few people take 90% of the income and the whole population takes the 10%.
So the very few people are in Iraq?
Yes. Yes, in Iraq and not in Iraq. They are in Iraq just to go and collect the money. And then how to spend the money outside Iraq. So their families are living outside Iraq, not in Iraq, but they come every now and then, and they have good positions that allow them to get the money and then go out. And this is well known. This is well known if you follow the CNN and other news. You can know what is the size, how many billions each name has, and I don't know that personally, but it is well known by many, media. Yeah.
Doctor, I have a question. Which, from your view, which one has bigger impact on health, terror or government corruption?
Do I have to answer this question? I think the corruption is another is the second face of terrorism. Terrorism is not only violence and guns.
I would say the related stuff.
Two questions, and I'm a little confused. Iraq is not the only corrupt country there. I mean, Pakistan from Pakistan, Pakistan is also very corrupt. But here's the thing. Based on what happened to Iraq, you would think that they should have closed all U.S. bases and thrown the Americans out. But they haven't. And they still are very much influenced by the U.S. policy. It surprises me still. And here, and also, it's not just the oil. The only one area I would say that opened up after the invasion was tourism. The Iraq gets about 1 million tourists a day. And that's one area, I mean, where they make a lot of money.
Exactly.
Nothing is coming up. It's 23 yeah. million people. Nowhere in the world you find that, such big crowds. So, they don't even need any aid from the U.S.
Yes.
So why, first, they're not able to, and this, the poverty, like you go to Karbala, you see the poverty. So I want to know why they're not able to fix just basic structure, just basic infrastructure. And secondly, why not throw the Americans out?
Well, first, I think I'm afraid that we will be out from Iraq. The Iraqi citizens someday will be out of Iraq because Iraq now is ruled by many countries, but not the Iraqis. I can certify that to you, okay? Second, we just said that the fortune is not distributed to the good work and building of Iraq. No, it's going somewhere else. And the problem is not problem of money. It's the problem of policy, of how to employ these funds and make it a good source to build the country. This is the problem. Yes, please.
It's more of a statement rather than a question. So I'm just going piggybacking on what she said. In any country after certain war or civil war, what happens is there's a whole lot of corruption, right? A lot of people are trying to survive within the moment, right? So in order to get momentum and to build your country, that's going to take quite some time. I'm from Somalia. We're still trying to build our country 25 years later, you know? So what's happening is there's a lot of outside influence. So even if there is a minimum of individuals that are there for the nation, the more corrupt people are in power. So what's happening is when you're building such as healthcare, infrastructure, stuff like that, every time there's someone that's out there that are messing up what you build. So it's a lot of people like come to the cleanse of privileged lens, and they assume that why are people not just automatically getting up and building? It is hard to be in there. You are trying to survive. You're trying to make the next neighbor not to kill you or any sort of like that. So I think sometimes when we ask questions, and I've seen several questions, we have to sort of take our privilege lens out, and we've been in America. I'm from Somalia, but I left Somalia at a young age. But I've been in America. I'm very privileged in a sense. So let's be careful in how we ask questions. The Iraq people are trying to build. But you had every corner that you're coming, there is some people that are trying to...
Thank you. Exactly, I can't take any more. Yes. Yes. Exactly. This was happening, yeah. I can't agree more. Yes, like making the people after a long time of suffering and torture and violence, they pushing them to the point that they say, we don't want money, we don't just to live in peace. And this is now what's happening. No one is, very few is thinking of building the country. I mean, the population, not the... But everyone is now thinking of how to keep safe for himself and his family. And this was a smart policy of the bad guys. Devilish, yes, but smart, because this is like exhausting the community, pushing them to this point that they will not claim anything, but just keeping them in peace. Yes. Yes, please.
With the U.S. election coming up, and I mean, the entire world is watching this election because the U.S. election affects everyone in the world. And for a lot of people, their lives are at stake based on who's in control of America. As an Iraqi, knowing what you know about the war in Iraq and how it started, and Hillary Clinton's role in that, do you have any opinion about how you would want to see the election go, or how you would
want to see the USA? Yeah. Sure. From our previous experiences, we think that it has nothing to do with us. It will never be a hope for the Iraqis, because none of the previous presidents in America has done anything of benefit to Iraq, okay? If not ever destroying Iraq. So we think that it makes no difference for us. Maybe it makes for you, good for you.
I want to thank you for staying in Iraq. And you and I had this conversation, a voice of such strong conscience to remain there and to be courageous enough to keep doing the work that you're doing. I think we all owe you a great debt of gratitude.
Thank you very much. Done.
Okay, we're going to give him the rest of the night off.
Thank you.
Before we close, I just want to acknowledge that when the U.S. invaded Iraq, this School of Public Health at the University of Washington really mobilized to support Iraqi people, to doing research on this. I am so proud of this institution and our School of Public Health, and many people in this room who have attended so many meetings to do this work, Mary Ann and Stephen and Dolphine and Dick Blakeney and the PSR people who are here, Physicians for Social Responsibility. I have so many students here who I'm very pleased you're here. Rita back there, who was so helpful in all of this.
And I second this appreciation to those people.
We just had a new paper come out this week. You can go find on Plus One. One of our MPH students used some of the data we collected for the period before 2003 and estimated the Iran-Iraq War mortality as well as the first Gulf War mortality using a new method. A lot of this is about developing methods, since we have such skinny budgets and, you know, this is not something NIH funds or CDC funds. When we do this work, it is volunteer. And it's only because of organizations like Health Alliance International that are willing to invest just enough to keep us alive that we can manage to do this. So thank you to all of you for doing this. Thank you to you for coming.
Thank you very much.
Marianne.